Latinos and Latinas made significant contributions in the factories, on the farms, and on the battlefields during World War II. Between a quarter and half a million Latinos actively served in the military, most of Mexican descent. Percentage-wise, they were the most highly decorated of any ethnic group. Serving with distinction, they received scores of medals, including the Purple Heart, the Bronze Star, and the Distinguished Service Cross. Of the 12 Latinos to receive the Medal of Honor, 5 were Tejanos.
The Congressional Medal of Honor was created by President Abraham Lincoln in 1861, just after the start of the Civil War. Originally, at its creation, it was intended only for members of the U.S. Navy and Marine Corps, but later in the war it was extended to the Army and other branches. There's 4 basic criteria that must be met for the award. First of all, it's only awarded in battle against enemies of the United States. That means, in other words, it cannot be awarded for if the Army is brought in to quell a civil disturbance in America. Secondly, it must involve risk of the person's life. Third, that risk must be beyond the call of duty. In other words, it must be conspicuous. It must be far beyond what other comrades might be performing. After all, everyone in the military does it to some extent risks their life. And a fourth criteria is there must be incontestable proof of its being deserved. That usually involves testimony from at least 2 eyewitnesses, including one's superior officer, but not all always. I mean, there can be other proofs that are used. But to show just how stringent the requirements are, since the Civil War, there were only 120 awarded during the course of World War I. In World War II, where over 16 million Americans served in the military, only 441 were awarded. In Vietnam, 5 million served, only 240 received the medal. And since Vietnam, there have only been 2 recipients, both for participants in the Black Hawk Down incident in Somalia. Persian Gulf I and Persian Gulf II, there were no awards made. So you can see this is truly the greatest award for bravery an American can win.
Jose M. Lopez was born on July 10, 1910. He never knew his father and lost his mother at the age of 9. Despite being orphaned at an early age and having less than 2 years of formal education, Lopez had a strong work ethic and even stronger faith.
Cuando ando buscando a mi tío, Constancio Mendoza, llegué, crucé la frontera y comencé a piscar. Y dormía yo en las semillas del algodón caliente. Y por varios tiempos, hasta que después ya me fui para, agarré el freight train y me fui para California.
These qualities led him from working in the fields around Mission, Texas, to moving to California in the late 1920s. It would also be these qualities that would contribute to his later success. While in California, Lopez worked as a cook on merchant ships in San Francisco. He then received his seaman's papers in New York. On a return trip to Brownsville, he married his sweetheart, Amelia Pineda. They would eventually have 5 children. However, the journey did not stop in Brownsville. In the early 1930s, Lopez pursued a boxing career. He fought for the lightweight championship of the British Isles.
In Atlanta, Georgia, un hombre me agarró y era mi manager y andaba peleando y lightweight. Y luego me fui a Tennessee y también peleé y estuve ganando los pleitos. So Una vez que me agarraron y fui a pelear a un campeón en Melbourne, Australia, apodo de Champion of England, Jackie Burgess. Me ganó, no me tumbó, pero le dieron el que él ganó, porque era campeón. So, ahí dejé los guantes, ya no peleé más.
The United States declared war on Japan after the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941. World War II would change the life of Jose M. Lopez and millions of other Americans. Lopez enlisted for the Army on April 8, 1942, in San Antonio, Texas. He joined Company K, 2nd Infantry Division of the U.S. Army as a machine gunner. He trained in Texas and Wisconsin before being shipped to Europe. And before he left, he made a promesa to La Virgen de Guadalupe, asking her to ensure his safety. In England, he fought in the Battle of Omaha Beach. In France, he fought at Normandy Beach. After continued fighting on French soil, he received the Purple Heart for wounds received in action and the Bronze Star for conspicuous gallantry against the enemy. However, it was his extraordinary gallantry in a battle near Krinkelt, Belgium, on December 17, 1944, that would earn Lopez the Medal of Honor from the United States.
Llegamos en Belgium y nos dijeron, vamos a estar en ese lugar, vamos a hacer todo lo posible, no importa lo que pase, sostener el lugar. Y me dieron ese lugar, a mí ya era yo machine gunner. Y ahí usé la machine gunner sin el trap pad, bastante munición, yo solo. Y cuando los alemanes, en una carretera que había aquí, los alemanes iban a entrar, comenzaron a llegar y un tanque americano le pegaron. Me arranqué, me trepé y pregunté que si alguien estaba vivo. Nadie. Me bajé y me fui para mi lugar. Y al rato comenzaron a atacar. ¿Qué campan estaba acá? Y yo estaba aquí. Y comencé, conforme los veía bien vestidos los alemanes, comencé a tirar.
He had a clearing in front of him where he could see the road. And he knew his guys were a quarter of a mile down the road sitting around a campfire. And finally, whatever this diesel engine was, it came into view. And by golly, it was a German Tiger tank. Not an ordinary tank, a Tiger tank with the heavy armor and the big cannon. And immediately behind that tank are German foot soldiers marching along following it. So Jose didn't have much time to think about, geez, what do I do now? The easiest, I mean, his machine gun's worthless against a tank. And you got all those soldiers, and they're in a quarter mile, they're going to come across the 40 guys in his company who are sitting around a fire. So he only had a couple seconds to think about, geez, what am I going to do? Well, he aimed that machine gun, and bear in mind, he'd been using it for 6 months, and he was good with it. And he opened fire on the foot soldiers who were following that tank. Everybody in his view, he cut them down. Now, he knew his shots would warn the other guys. Now Jose wanted to leave. But immediately more foot soldiers run around the trees and out into the clearing. So he had to cut those guys down. Tank stops. The turret on the tank rotates with his great big gun pointing right at him. He can't get up and run away because these soldiers, you know, would obviously chase him and shoot him in the back. He has to keep cutting down these soldiers who just keep coming. Finally, the tank gets all loaded, fires this great big shell, and he could hear it and feel it. Went over his head, hit way back there harmlessly. And he's like, I got to get out of here. And every time he tries to get up, you know, there's more soldiers, and he has to shoot them. And the tank fired a second time. Still went over his head and missed. And, you know, he wants to leave, but the soldiers keep coming. The third time the tank shot, that big shell hit right in front of him. And the concussion lifted his machine gun right up over his head and picked him literally right up out of his little hole and blew him and the gun over backwards. And to this day, he can't really hear in his right ear. You know, he's got a service disability because of a German Tiger tank fired point blank at him. Well, he's dazed and stunned, just like it says. His machine gun is now, you know, laying there in the dirt. He grabbed that gun and he ran backwards. And there's still German foot soldiers chasing him and shooting at him. As he went back, he says, I mean, you know, maybe 150 feet. And there was another line of trees. He flopped down in front of those trees on his stomach, set up his gun, and then cut down all the German soldiers who were chasing him. The tank reloads, and the tank is still shooting at him. And it's, you know, for tanks, it's close. But all of its shells hit the trees behind him. You know, when a shell hits the tree explodes. You know, splinters go everywhere. And he picked up a few splinters, which were the only wounds that he got. And he kept shooting, you know, at the German foot soldiers who were coming at him. Now, in the meantime, the 40 guys, you know, all this ruckus, you know, they got up and left. Because by golly, there are Germans in the woods. And, whoever was in command said, you know, Jose, Lopez has got to be running low on ammunition. You know, see if you can get this to them. And they had a couple cans of ammo. Well, as they kind of sneak up through the back of the woods, you know, sort of like behind Jose, I mean, there's all these small arms and tank firing going on. They couldn't get very close to Jose. So they got as close as they could, and then they threw the cans of ammo to Jose. And Jose, you know, loads them up and fires off those, because he was out. And he fires off those last two cans. And, you know, now he's out of ammunition, grabs that machine gun, puts it on his back, and runs through the woods where he finds those five guys that brought him the ammo, and they all run back to Krinkelt, which was about a mile.
Al fin de que se me acabó toda la munición, la nieve estaba a la más de la rodilla. Agarré la gun y me la puse en el hombro y me fui para Krinko, Belgium, donde había otros compañeros y nos unimos para hacer otro frente. Ahí me dieron crédito por lo que hice. Peleamos hasta que entró otra división y ya nos compusimos y seguimos peleando hasta que llegamos a Checoslovaquia. Ahí en Checoslovaquia, a nosotros, por los puntos que teníamos, nos mandaban para Estados Unidos y nos pusieron en tanques, en troques, con todo el equipment de uno para ir para Estados Unidos. Y llegamos a Alemania y todos los que iban conmigo se desembarcaron y los belices que llevaban y todo. Y comenzaron a decir, Sayan López, Sayan López, pull all your gear back in the truck. Y puse todo mi, dije, ay, ay, ay. Y me fui con todos los troques para Checoslovaquia, para atrás. A las 3 de la mañana, en el hallway, I fell asleep. Next morning, everybody was looking for Sayan López. And then my buddy, they said, they permanent back. He said, you won the Congressional Medal of Honor. And my company commander, he said, I take you back. And he got a jeep and brought me back to Nuremberg in Germany to meet General James Van Fleet. And he was the one, he presented me the Congressional Medal of Honor.
At the end of the war, he returned to Brownsville, Texas, a hero's welcome. A downtown parade was held in his honor. And shortly afterward, he and his family traveled to Mexico City to pay the promesa he had made to the Virgen de Guadalupe before the war.
Rezaba yo bastante por la Virgen de Guadalupe. Bastante. Rezaba yo mucho por la Virgen de Guadalupe. Y se me concedió de que triunfé a acabar todo el combate. Cuando acabamos todo y vine a Estados Unidos, ya después que regresamos, fui a la capital de México a ver la Virgen de Guadalupe. ¡Qué lindo!
While there, the government of Mexico held a parade and a banquet in his honor. And upon his return, he was offered employment with the city of Brownsville. However, the Veterans Administration in San Antonio offered him employment as a veterans contact representative. Here, he would work alongside with other Medal of Honor recipients. San Antonio now became his home. He reenlisted in 1947 and again during the Vietnam War, where he was stationed in Korea. Sergeant Lopez has not only been a courageous soldier, but a caring father as well.
My name is John Lopez, and I'm a firstborn son. What Jose and Emilia mean to me is strength. You know, we had it tough in the beginning when I was growing up. He had just joined the service and had been shipped out for training at Camp McCoy, Wisconsin, California, Camp Roberts, and in Louisiana, right before the war started. I guess the war had actually already started because of Pearl Harbor. And during this time, Mother and I were in Brownsville, and there were some family support there, but it was not the same as having him right there with us. What Jose means to me is that he has always been a stalwart. He was a disciplinarian, to say the least, in growing up, but that was good for me and for the rest of the family, the kids growing up. I believe that there has been a lot of love and there has been a lot of loyalty from the kids back to them both, mom and dad. I think we've learned a lot in terms of giving out to others and receiving at the same time.
Okay, my name is Beatriz Lopez de Pedraza. I was raised in a Mexican family. My parents are bilingual, and I'm a United States citizen. I've now traveled the world with my husband, and the more and more I see of this world, the more proud I am to be a Mexican American. And I also, as I grow older, the more proud I am also of being the daughter of a Medal of Honor winner. My father, Jose Mendoza Lopez, won the Congressional Medal of Honor in World War II, the Battle of the Bulge. And I grew up with a very humble man. And most people who knew him, either through just community services or work environment, very few of them knew that who he was and what he stood for. So often I was brought to tears by, you know, some of the things that my father endured in life. And it was often other people who had to tell, you know, people who my father was.
I'm Marie Perotti, and I'm the oldest of the girls. And I think my youngest, my baby sister, really put everything in perspective. Because school children should have some kind of goals in life and know that this country is a great country and see what this man did with no education and made the best of what he could do. And look what he's offered. Look what kind of freedom we have because of people are human beings like this man sitting here. I think that's just what a person should really focus on. What can they do for this country?
My name is Virginia Rogers. When I was growing up, I really didn't know my dad, but he tried to know us. He took us to Germany. I thought that was the best time of my life, is going to Germany and enjoying everything. And then he took us to see Elvis Presley, and Elvis Presley came to the car. Then he took us to Hollywood. And then a couple of times I'd turn on TV and my dad was behind Bob Hope or Raquel Welch. And I thought my dad was a movie star.
My name is Maggie Wickwire. I'm the daughter of Jose M. Lopez. And I'm 55 years old. I have three other siblings. And it was a wonderful day today because we've all came together today to celebrate Jose and his 93rd birthday. And he is often saying to me, I can't believe I'm 93, look at me, you know. And he is continuing to be young. I think he forgets he's 93, that's why he continues to remind me that he's 93. And so he's keeping his health up, he's exercising, and he wants to live a life he always lived, and that was to be in perfect health and perfect mind and in self-control. And I think that this is one example of why he did so well when he was younger. I mean, he probably didn't have direction when he was growing up, but in spite of that, he learned to direct himself, to do the right thing, and he knows that by doing the right thing, he would always be blessed. When I talk about my dad, I get very emotional, and I have a lot to say about him. He is a true hero, and I love him very much, and I just know that God has blessed him.
Soldiers today respect and admire Jose Mendoza Lopez and are keenly aware of his legacy to them.
And we continue to see the Hispanic soldiers, and we have done that for 227 years. They have done it pretty much the old-fashioned way. They've done it on the battlefields, during different wars and on different campaigns. We have a lot to be proud of, very much so, and Sergeant Lopez, again, is really, again, the role model and example that we all envy and all look up to. I met his daughter about 20 plus years ago, and I think she and I never realized that the Medal of Honor that he had was as important as we find that it is today. He's a very modest man. He kept it to himself, and what he knew, he didn't talk about. There's an interesting point about a soldier. We worship peace more than anyone else. We go to war because we have to, and because, like Sergeant Lopez said, he was called to duty. So I would just close by saying that we're the ones that are honored and privileged tonight to be around a soldier who gave up his life, gave up his family, gave up his time to join the armed forces, and only to walk away with what only 40 other Hispanics have done in the history of the Army, and that's when the Congressional Medal won.
At 93, Sergeant Lopez still exercises daily and at times sings what he sang as a young man on the battlefields of Europe.
Una mañana de frío invierno, ante el banquillo se me sacó. Salió el juez de letras y liberano, y como culpable me sentenció. Penas de muerte era mi causa. Yo no me explico lo que sentí, pero aseguramente que como un niño me estremecí. 5 años en Bartolina, un pajarillo me fue a cantar, y era mi madre en figura de ave que a su hijo amado fue a consolar.
The We Are and the Guard, they give me this privilege, the strength to be before wonderful people in Brownsville. It was so many, many years ago that I was here with my wife. And it's something I feel in my heart. There is a big memory to remember when I was here in Brownsville and working in the Jardín Hotel. As good memories that never forget, and give it God. Thank you for giving me this privilege and the strength to be before you people, and thank you. And God bless America, and God bless everyone.
From the mountains to the prairies, and to the oceans wide with foam, God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, and God bless America.
A hero is defined as a man who is admired for his achievements and noble qualities. A valiant man. Throughout his life and today, José Mendoza López remains un hombre valiente, a valiant man.